Hello everybody. This video is to explain the whole purpose of this project of running the underground conduit from the shed over to the garage with these three neatly placed conduits. First one is a half inch. The next one is 1 inch. And the next one is 1¼ inches. The half inch is running two Cat 5 Ethernet cables, which go all the way over to the front of the house where my networking equipment is. Why did I do that? Well, I installed a really, really neat IP camera on the tippy top of the shed. I'll show you that later. The second thing I did, which I'm extremely happy about, is a half inch air hose. Oh yeah. This 90 degree is just sitting there, so it acts as a swivel. So you can swivel it whichever direction you want. And once the wall is done, this will be strapped to the wall so none of these pipes will flop around. Okay, so the third cable, The third conduit, 1¼ inch conduit, it's going to be running electric lines to the shed. What I'm going to run today is the for 120 volts. I've had this box for over 5 years, I think. I've had this box unopened. I don't think I'll ever use it for any other purpose. I don't believe in directly burying wire in the ground unprotected by conduit. I don't think I would ever do that. So I'm just gonna use it for this. And that'll be, I'll have a switch when you open the door in the shed, and the switch will turn the light on inside. I'll probably use this fluorescent light fixture. I'll probably mount this one on the ceiling. I currently have it set up as a portable light that I put under the car whenever I'm working on it, but that's just asking, you know. It's just gonna break eventually because there's nothing protecting it, you know. I'd rather just hang it up in the shed over there. So I think this video is gonna be really cool. I learned this on the internet. The easy way to run cable, rather than trying to stick it in here and push it and hope that you're gonna get it underground and all the way over there, this is over 60 feet away, and you've got this is the only place I use 90 degree conduit. I don't believe in using 90 degrees because you're just asking for a lot of resistance when you're trying to pull a cable through. What I like to do is use two 45 degrees together. This is how I've done it. As you can see, it's a more gradual, easy bend. It offers a lot less resistance when you're trying to pull something through. Anyway, that's enough of that. I'm trying to keep this video short. Well, I made this box. This is what's going to be inside the shed. I'm just going to pop it on here as an example for you to see. So the wire is going to come into this box. That wire there, I probably should open it and show you. For those of you who are not familiar with 12-2, it's just like the wire that's in your house that's yellow. But because this is direct burial, it's gray. But if you look at the size of it, it's like a half inch wide or whatever, and you see the shape of it right there. So it's going to come in through here, and I drilled this hole and I attached this. This is called a watertight connector, whatever. Look at the size of that. Look at the shape of it. So what happens is that wire will go through there, and then you'll put it here, and when you tighten down on this, it'll squeeze down on the rubber and make that watertight, so I don't have to worry about bugs crawling into this box and somehow working their way back into the garage. That's one thing I really I don't want any bugs crawling from the shed into the garage and into the house. I don't. It's my biggest fear with this thing. So, oh, I'm giving it away. All right, I bought another one of these because these are RJ45 jacks. No, this is called a Decora Keystone insert. I'm not going to use this white part. I'm not going to use a frame. I just need to replace this because I broke the one that's in the shed. Yes, I gave it away. I have two Ethernet cable jacks that I wired up in the shed. I have the camera plugged into one, and the other one I haven't decided what I'm going to do yet, but when I do things, I always like to do things where I leave room for expansion, and God only knows what I'll decide to plug into there. And this is the lid for that box, again, to keep the bugs out. It's got that rubber gasket. Really nice stuff. I really like this PVC stuff. And the way I had this box, when you buy it, I bought this at Lowe's. It came completely with no holes. So obviously, I drilled a hole. I put that through. It was really tight. And I put that in there just for extra security. It was unnecessary because it was on there really tight. You know, that nut that goes on the threading there. And then this, I had to drill a hole. And this was an insert that I glued in place. And then I had to change it from a male to a female. So this is another adapter that I glued and pushed onto that adapter. So now this simply can go on top of the pipe in the shed like I showed you. It's really neat. I mean, I've never done this before, but you kind of can figure these things out. You just go to the store and you stare at all the boxes and the fittings and the options that you have, and you kind of come up with your own idea. So the reason why, let me show you. I'm going to use this cable here. This is 60 amp. This is good for 60 amp. It's got four wires in it. They're all 6 gauge. Wait a minute. The ground is a little smaller. Probably 8 gauge for the ground. And so you have black and red, which is the hot. And then the neutral is the white. And the green is the ground. I'm going to put a 50 amp outlet at the shed for the welder. I can use a welder out there. Or I can, for the future, I'm always thinking about the future now, you know, you never know. I might have an electric car someday. I'm probably leaning more towards a diesel vehicle because of the long distances that I drive. But, you know, what if I sell the house? What if somebody that buys a house will have an electric vehicle? They could plug their electric car charger out there and they could plug it into the shed. You know, not everybody doesn't like to park their car in the garage all the time. Sometimes it's not convenient. Like if it's raining outside, you don't want to drive your car into the garage and get it all wet inside. So having the ability to plug your car in and charge it at the shed, it's a good option, I think. Or, you know, if I decide I want to turn the shed into a little workshop, then hey, I've got 220 volts for the my mind went blank here. For the welder, and then I'll have 120 volts for the, you know, lighting or regular appliances that, you know, are not heavy duty or whatever. Well, I'll show you while I'm here. That's my alarm system. I installed it. I programmed it with this, with my laptop. This is a special Honeywell modem, and you can program the circuit board. I have a much better alarm system, more advanced than this, and I'm going to be taking this out of service. And the reason why I'm going to put a better alarm system in here is because I have these touch screens. Please excuse my basement. I'm in the process of doing the same thing I did to the garage, you know, painting the walls with the rubber paint, and then insulating it with this stuff, and then, you know, refinishing it with 2x4s and stuff. And I did the foam all on the top. That's all foamed in. Anyway, I'm getting off topic. Here we go. These panels, touch screens. I can punch in my code.
Armed, away, exit now.
You can't really read what's in the red. It's too bright for the camera. It says 51 seconds remaining on the top. Nothing but the best. I always like to get the best of everything if I can't, if I can help it. So I have one of these down here in the basement, and I have one up upstairs in the living room where the fireplace is. And then in my bedroom, I have a different kind of touchpad. I have this one in my bedroom, and I'm in the garage now. So I have two of these and two of those. And this system, actually, if it gets triggered, armed away. Now the one with the touchscreen, it verbally said armed away, but since we were in the garage, you didn't hear that. So now if I go back into the house, because the garage doesn't have any motion sensors, that's why I came out here. If I open this door, forget it. Yeah, this is fun. Let's do it. My alarm talks. See that motion sensor there? It lit up. I have another motion sensor over there. I think I walked in too soon. I'm surprised it didn't go off. I think it takes a minute for everything to relax. I'm really surprised it didn't go off. That shouldn't be. I think I'm gonna have to cut this part of the video out. Oh, I know why. It says alarm stay. You know the reason why? I still don't have a sensor on that laundry room door, so it thinks I stayed home. I'll have to do this again. Let's see, disarm.
Disarm, ready to arm.
These alarms are pretty smart. Away. So you have to open the door because there's a switch on the door. It's a really neat one. Look, that little thing right there. And on top of the door, there's a little magnet recessed in there, and it knows when you left. Okay. I've even my cool sticker. They may be subject to video monitoring. That is so true. It's not even a lie, not even a bluff. All right, we got 49 seconds left. I'm gonna walk out into the garage. Well, I'll let you hear the voice this time. Jeez, guys, it's 15 minutes, I'm sorry. But I think this is interesting, so I think you're gonna be okay with this video being 20 minutes long. It's gonna have a grand finale, I promise you. You're gonna really enjoy the last part of this video, so just hang in there. Because I'm holding something in my hand that's gonna entertain you. Now, I bet you guys are wondering, what the hell is he holding in his hand that's gonna be so entertaining? I'm trying not to move. Yeah, the alarm beeps like that at the end to confirm that the system is armed. Alright, so if I start moving now, it's going to trigger this system. Yeah.
You have violated a protected area. The police have been called. Leave immediately. You have violated a protected area. The police have been called. Leave immediately. You have violated a protected area. The police have been called. Leave immediately.
Oh my.
You have violated a protected area. The police have been called. Leave immediately. You have violated a protected area. The police have been called. Leave immediately. You have violated a protected area. The police have been called. Leave immediately.
You have violated a protected area. The police have been called.
Leave immediately.
Ready to arm.
Okay, so let me explain a little bit. You saw how the screen was telling you the different names of the sensors. It was I typed that all in there. So one of the things about this alarm is that I have the switches all over the house. I kind of regret going in this direction, but hey, it's already done. You see, you just push them and it makes a click. These are remote controlled switches. I've got it in the dining room, the kitchen, the living room, the front light outside on the front deck, the bathroom, the hallway, downstairs in the basement, in the laundry room. I have a whole shitload of switches that I could control from this screen. But here's a problem, and I really wish you could see this. All it says is output 1, output 2, output 3, output 4, output 5, output 6. Now, yeah, you can kind of see it there now. I don't like that, guys. I want to know, this alarm, the new one, this is the new one. Look at the size of that circuit board. It's freaking huge. Because it has a more sophisticated brain and it has the capability to actually name those light switch outputs. So it would say living room, kitchen, dining room, bathroom, you know, and I would be able to, here, let me, you hear that click? Look, beep, and then you're gonna hear a click. Now those lights are on because these are number 1 and number 2. So now let me demonstrate. I'll shut it off. Off, off. And now they're off. And that works everywhere. I've got it here too. Excuse my kitchen, guys. I'm working. I live alone. I'm doing the best I can. So this is going to be an outlet for a new kitchen counter that's going to go across here. I'm going to put a dedicated outlet for a refrigerator and a water connector that'll go to my drinking water filter for the refrigerator to make ice. See? and this is what I'm putting in. That is a little outlet box that goes in the wall, and the water line, I think it's a 3/8 water line. What is this? 3/8. 3/8 line will go here in the basement, up behind the sink where the water filter is, and then I'll have this T connector, because I currently have the water filter faucet at the kitchen sink. That's where I drink the water from. It's filtered water. It's really neat. And I put this on the floor in the living room just to remind me to do it. It'll kind of like annoy me to do the work that needs to be done. Guys, I'm sorry. I think this video is going to be about a half hour long. All right. Here's the exciting part. Oh, I almost tripped and broke my ass for you guys. All right. Yeah, you saw all that lumber on the floor, because I have to do that wall there. And I'm planning on tearing down that wall right there. So it's going to be one big room. That wall right here used to have a sliding glass door, and I paid some masons to like block it off and make it like there was never anything there. So after I'm done, that wall is done. All I have to do now is wrap it up in this stuff, like the garage, and then put the 2x4s. See, I have more 2x4s. Oh, cool. I get to show you my new toilet. Brand new. It's a cheap version. It doesn't have the... there's one that's more expensive that'll... If you slam the door, it'll go down like this really slow. But this one's just a regular toilet seat. Guys, how many times do you ever put the toilet seat down? I don't. So, I settled for less. It was close to $300. I like it. I forget how much I paid for it. $287 at Home Depot. And then I had a $25 coupon from Lowe's. And if you ever have a coupon from Lowe's, you can take it to Home Depot and they'll honor it. And vice versa. If you have a Lowe's coupon, you can go to Home Depot. If you have a Home Depot coupon and there's something at Lowe's you want to buy, you can give them the coupon. They'll honor it. And then I have this brand new Energy Seal attic ladder. I did that because I decided I'm going to install it up here. I took the ceiling apart. I'm in the process of doing that. So it's going to go up there. So when you open the attic ladder, the ladder is going to go down to that floor there, so you can enter from there, from that side. And then I've got this here. It's like a little tent that you put over, you know, the attic ladder. And unfortunately, the little Pink Panther is not included, but what are you going to do, right? Well, yeah. So the reason I got that and this is because there was no way to get up into the attic. And I decided that this would be the best place to put the attic ladder. But the ceiling that was here, if you notice those strips that are going across, it's because they had these little cardboard foam tiles that were stuck there. And all of the heat from that pellet stove, I would lose it. All the heat would go up into the attic and it would melt the snow on the roof. So I knew that, you know, all the heat I was generating with this highly efficient machine, it was going up in smoke. Pellet stove burns pellets. And supposedly it's carbon neutral. It's good for the environment. I ordered about 6 tons from woodpellets.com, I think it was. And this thing, it's like, keeps me warm, really, really warm. But a lot of the heat from this also gets lost in the concrete being exposed like this. The concrete and the concrete floor absorbs all the heat from this. So it takes a while for the house to get warm, which is why I'm doing that insulating crap. But this basement is always cool. This basement is always cool because I have this hybrid water heater, which I love this thing. This was one of the best purchases I've made besides the pellet stove. The one that they sell at Lowe's now does not look like this, which I'm kind of glad I bought this. I was an early adopter. I paid $1,500 for it minus whatever rebates I got back. I don't remember. But this thing is awesome. It's dual purposed. The best place to put it is in the basement because it dehumidifies the air around you. So it dehumidifies the air down here and it keeps it cool and dry. And then it's basically like a air conditioning unit. And you know the heating coils that are on an air conditioner? Well, those are submerged in the water tank. And of course, this blows cool air out. And just like any air conditioner, this little hose right here, you get your condensation from inside the unit and it goes into this. This is a, this basically will fill up with water. And when it gets to a certain amount, it'll pump this water out into the drain on the other side of the room. And I was smart about it. When I bought this pump, I bought a 220 volt version because this machine runs on 220 volts. So I put a 220 volt outlet in there and it's running off the same circuit for the hot water heater. So see, hot water heater, boom, same thing. All right. This is a whopper of a video, guys. I know. All right, so let me get to the grand finale. I'm gonna try to make this 30 minutes, but it's probably too late. It'll be like 32. What am I gonna show you now? Where's my vacuum cleaner? There it is. So, there's a vacuum cleaner. It's a baby shop vac. I'm gonna stick the vacuum cleaner into the hose there. I'm going to turn it on. Oh, I unplugged it. Let me plug it in. Okay, here's the other end of that inch and a quarter line. Look, when I put my hand on it, you hear that suction? Well, I took a glove and I tied it onto a string. And what I'm gonna do is, I'm just gonna put it right there over the pipe. Look at that. Whee! Look how fast that's going. That's it. So that glove is now in the garage, inside the vacuum cleaner. And that is the quickest way to... My camera got really dark all of a sudden, and I don't know why. But if I pull the vacuum cleaner out, there's the glove, guys. Tell me that is not cool. So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to run. Let me stop this for a minute.